they're some of the world's most in-demand tech jobs.
The advantage of the robot is that it is able to give us very high dexterity and maneuverability in a very small and narrow confined space, which normally a human hands may have a bit of difficulty reaching.
For car parts, car body will be carried by our robots. So car body during assembly process will carry by the bigger robot and go through different assembly process.
What we are really focusing on is developing the capabilities of our robotic platforms to help the user in a home.
But what does a day in one of these roles actually look like? From helping with household chores, overseeing smart factories, to conducting surgery, they're all working with one technology, robotics. This is Most Wanted.
I'm here at Tan Tock Seng Hospital, and I'm here to see a surgeon that uses robots in his surgery. So come with me.
You can come in.
Chong Yew Lam has been a urologist for 16 years and leads the hospital's division of surgery. He uses a surgical robotic system called Da Vinci to help him perform complex surgeries in a minimally invasive way.
So this is what we call a robotic-assisted laparoscopic radical prostatectomy, which is a keyhole surgery through minimally invasive small incisions on the abdomen to remove the prostate. When we remove the prostate, it's not just removing and then we walk away. There's a need to also reconstruct and rejoin the bladder back to the urethra through suturing, small incisions and a shorter recovery post-operatively. That's the key part of the surgery.
While robotic surgeries have existed for more than two decades, it's still a novelty in the field of medicine. According to a study, the use of robotic surgery increased from 1.8% to 15.1% from 2012 to 2018.
Prof, we're going to leave you to it now.
Yeah,
we'll see you in a bit after the surgery. So we've just watched Prof Chong, hard at work with his team of doctors and nurses, and we're going to be speaking to him after he finishes his surgery in a couple of hours.
However, robots have been on factory floors for even longer, and they're getting smarter.
Nessa, welcome to our smart factory.
Wow, thank you. There's so many things happening.
Yep.
Kelvin Ching is a senior robotics engineer for Hyundai Motor Group Innovation Center Singapore, the country's first EV factory. He's showing me how robots assemble the IONIQ 6 model.
And what are these guys up to?
Okay, so for all these moving robots, we call them AMR, autonomous mobile robot. They actually handle a lot of stuff. From logistic area, they need to pick up car parts, or even bigger robot will carry car body, travel from cell to cell. Our factory is different from those traditional car manufacturing factory. We don't actually use conveyor. Our production system is a cell-based system. So for this cell, mainly it's just for bigger parts assembly.
So now we're going to see the robots put the wheels together.
So bigger robot used to pick up the wheels, smaller robot just put nuts onto the wheel.
There's six robots here?
Yep. For every cell, we have a different set of number of robots because every cell, we have designated processors.
And these are all robots developed by Hyundai's engineers?
Yes.
Right, and you're one of them.
Because for robotics engineer, people would just think that, okay, you just work on your laptop, programming every day. It's true, we need to do programming, but there's more to it. We still need to have some electrical knowledge, mechanical knowledge. So a bit of jack of all trade. Yeah.
Right.
So it make the work more interesting.
While Hyundai uses smart robots to automate manufacturing, what about smart robots at home? Dyson is known for its home appliances, but the company is looking to take that one step further. And all that work starts at its research lab managed by Sean Sebastian, Dyson's robotics research manager.
This setup that we have here has been set up by Sumit, who is our capable robot learning engineer. What he's going to show you is how the robotic arm would be able to recognize the scene,
okay,
understand the scene, make sense of it, and perform the task of tidying based on his prompt.
Sean likens teaching robots to an adult teaching a baby by demonstrating actions. The robot has two cameras that visually map the scene, and then it decides how it will execute an instruction.
He already provided the demonstrations, and now he's going to give them text prompt instructions to say, okay, now open the drawer. Now clear this toy.
This is what the robot sees right now.
Yes, yes, exactly. It has planned the path how to reach to the drawer handle.
Okay.
Right?
and now we're going to execute that part.
You think in opening just one drawer is, you know, simple task, but it's actually pretty complicated when you think about it.
Yeah, it's difficult for my son to do it as well.
I love how this is equatable to your four-year-old son.
Everything we do is for the consumer at home. So a lot of my biases come to it as well. I want him to do all his chores that I don't want to do.
What's the end goal for this?
Home is a very challenging environment. It's highly dynamic, it's unstructured. So that's why we have to make this technology reliable, repeatable, and not only that, we have to make it safe.
Here, it's really about, can we do it? Are we able to imbue such capabilities in our robotic technology?
Testing these robot prototypes before deploying them in a live setting is an important task for engineers and end users alike. Back in the operating room, I caught up with Yew Lam after his successful surgery on a man who was diagnosed with prostate cancer.
I can show you around. This is the console. Basically, it's like the flight deck where I use my hands to be able to control the controllers to maneuver the instruments in various directions, in and out, up and down, twist, rotation motion, and even move like a wrist. The pedals below looks a bit like an organ, so you must be able to use both your left and right feet all at the same time to control various instruments, the various energies you use to cut or to stop bleeding, etc. And also to control the movement of the camera. You're able to have stereoscopic vision or binocular vision, so you have depth perception.
But what if the robot breaks down? Yew Lam credits much of the heavy lifting to his team of nurses. Both surgeons and nurses in Singapore are trained in countries like Japan and the US to operate and troubleshoot the Da Vinci robots.
And you're transferring these skills to the next generation of surgeons?
Yeah, this handsome guy called Daniel.
Hi, Dr. Daniel. What made you want to do robotic surgery?
When I was training to be a urologist, robot surgery was one of the most exciting and developing space.
Was it a very steep learning curve for you?
First off, you have to do some computer simulation, some theoretical information that you need to know. Initially, we'll start off being an assistant. So yes, this is how you can change the robot instruments to control the robot arms. It takes a while though. It took at least 2 years before I could actually do a surgery.
Surgeries using the Da Vinci robot are widely practiced all over the world in multiple surgical procedures, including chest and heart surgery.
Certainly, this is something that I think some of the young surgeons look forward to. They think that it's interesting, they find it almost sexy. In coming years, as more and more robotic platforms are available, I think there'll be more competition as well, and that may help moderate some of the costs involved. But we also must be careful that such technology is not a one-size-fits-all for all surgeries.
This is my playground where I test my robot and my algorithm. We try to mimic the robot in our production.
Those are the robots you're referring to in the smart factory?
Yep. So what we did is we replaced the laser with a real-time locating system sensors. This actually brings down the cost of the robot and actually provide a much accurate positioning as well.
In the same building, a robotic arm is being tested to move car parts around the factory floor.
It's designed to be deployed at the logistics site where we pick parts from our warehouse into set boxes that you see over here. In these set boxes, they comprise a combination of different parts. So the assembly team will then take these parts and assemble them.
When you said playground, you weren't kidding. This playing with robots and driving them all day. This is like every kid's dream job.
Yeah.
However, in robotics, playing is serious business, especially in a home environment.
Whatever technologies we develop in the lab, we can come here to the home environment to test it out with the similar lighting conditions, similar household appliances. Over here, what we have is a robotic arm in front of an oven. It uses the latest in generative AI techniques. We don't provide any information of the oven to the robot. The forces, especially for an oven, it's quite heavy forces. The robot has to deal with that. So there's a lot of uncertainty.
It's taking the RGB images from the environment and then predicting constantly what's the path to take.
This kind of really informs us where we should really place our sensors once we go about designing the product.
So you guys are all robotics engineers. What's it like?
Robotics, it's an interdisciplinary field. People see successful videos of the robotic demos, but that's actually not usually the case because as a roboticist, you know that it fails multiple times before it reaches a success.
I think even if we fail, it's very important that we learn why we fail so that we don't, fear failure, but embrace it.
The moment you actually, like, as a team, make something happen, yeah. And it's really exciting seeing.
Besides understanding the technicalities of the machines they're operating, robotic engineers are also expected to have programming skills and an understanding of how different technologies can be integrated together.
In this field, technology are evolving every day, so we definitely need to be curious about all the latest technology.
People always say robots will take over your jobs. What do you think about that?
Human and robot are actually harmonized, working together. So for robot, as you can see, they are doing some repetitive tasks, where for human like us, we will just work on more innovative tasks and work on some R&D.
This technology is here to stay.
Robotic surgery or any new technology platform that provides improved visibility, improved dexterity and precision will always have a place in surgery. The tool doesn't define you as a surgeon. It's making sure that you identify the right conditions and the right application, the right tools for the right patients.